1991년 2월 24일 미 해병대가 쿠웨이트시를 향해 북쪽으로 진격을 개시한 지 10시간 후 지상군의 본 공격이 진행되었다. 이라크군의 배후를 치는 일명 레프트 훅이라는 대대적인 기갑 작전이었다.
We wanted to attack them and hit them in the flank before they knew the direction and the size of the attack.
Ready to roll, whatever. Good, we're running good.
레프트 훅을 치는 임무는 프레드 프랭크스 중장이 이끄는 제7군단이 맡았다. 목표는 이라크군의 최정예 핵심 전력이라고 할 수 있는 공화국 수비대의 3개 기갑사단을 섬멸하는 것이었다.
We knew that the Republican Guards, who were well-armed, well-equipped, the best trained of the Iraqi forces, who were really our principal mission and our focus of our attack, that they would fight back, that they would attempt to maneuver, and that they were a much more skillful and motivated force than the frontline Iraqi units.
해병대가 공격했던 이라크군은 징집병으로 구성된 전방부대로서 훈련도 부족하고 장비도 형편없었다. 게다가 연합군의 공습으로 심한 타격을 받은 상태였다. 하지만 공화국 수비대는 상황이 달랐다.
There were three heavy divisions, armored mechanized divisions equipped with the Soviet T-72 tanks, very good tanks, and the BMPs, first line infantry carriers. So it was good equipment. Our intelligence said they were disciplined, they were tough, they would fight to the death.
공화국 수비대는 쿠웨이트 북부의 국경선을 따라 7개 사단을 포진해 놓았다. 미군은 제7군단의 5개 사단과 18군단 소속 4개 사단을 동원해 진격했다. 그러다가 쌍방은 최강의 부대끼리 전투를 치르게 되었다. 미 제7군단 소속 3개 기갑사단 대 공화국 수비대 소속 기갑사단인 타르와카나, 메디나, 그리고 함무라비 사단과의 격돌이었다.
We started out attacking to the north, and then we would have to turn 90 degrees to the east in essentially a left hook. I wanted to do that without stopping and to hit the Republican Guards with a three armored division fist, approximately over 1,000 tanks and some 600 infantry fighting vehicles.
모래바람을 뚫고 공화국 수비대를 찾아 진격하던 제7군단의 최선봉은 맥마스터 대위가 이끄는 기갑중대였다.
We really were going into an uncertain situation and we were doing our job as cavalry troopers. We were going out, riding out in front of the main formation, much like cavalry has done in centuries past, to find the enemy's defensive positions.
지상전에 돌입한 지 60시간이 되던 무렵 모래 언덕에 숨어있던 타라카나 사단 이하의 한 기갑 여단이 갑자기 나타났다. 서로 물러설 수 없이 가까운 거리였다.
So immediate what happened is the entire crew went into action. Sergeant Koch, my gunner, is engaging targets. Our loader is loading the appropriate ammunition, yelling up and arming the gun. Well, Sergeant Koch lays on the next target and destroys it.
They attacked in a sandstorm. And so a lot of units, maybe that weren't perhaps as well trained as they, weren't as confident as they, might have stopped and just called artillery and waited till the sandstorm stopped. The Iraqis were surprised that they attacked in that bad weather.
What I remember most vividly are the first rounds from our tank. The first round was a heat round, so it made a tremendous explosion as it hit the enemy tank. I remember the tank commander was thrust out of the hatch of the tank and he himself was on fire. As my tank was moving to engage other enemy tanks, we got three rounds off just before our other eight tanks came up over the ridge and were able to engage the enemy. And what I remember then is the entire enemy defense seemed to explode in a ball of fire.
It all is summed up in my mind by a report that I asked for from all of the senior Iraqis who were captured. When did you first know you were under attack? I mean, this is all the lieutenant colonels and generals. The most common answer that the Iraqis responded, we knew we were under attack when the vehicles around me started to explode.
불과 30초 만에 소련제 T-72를 필두로 한 이라크 탱크 8대가 화염에 휩싸였다. 미군의 M1A1 탱크는 거의 철벽에 가까운 철제 장갑 덕에 끄떡없었다. 63톤이나 나가는 육중한 무게였지만 사막에서도 시속 56km의 속력으로 움직일 수 있었다. 거기에다 120mm 활강포의 위력 또한 대단했다.
The rate of fire of our weapon systems was a tremendous advantage. We could fire about 3 rounds for every 1 round of the Iraqi tanks. The Iraqi tanks relied on automatic loaders, and those automatic loaders were cumbersome. They took a long time to get a second round in. So while we know of 4 Iraqi tanks that fired at us, no Iraqi tanks got a second round off.
23분 동안의 교전 끝에 이라크 탱크 30대와 장갑차 16대가 파괴된 반면 미군은 단 한 대의 피해도 없었다. 불과 9대의 탱크로 수적으로 4배가 넘는 이라크의 최정예 기갑사단 병력을 섬멸시키는 대전과를 올린 것이다.
It was an enormously successful attack for our corps. It fixed the Republican Guard's defense. It discovered the southern edge of the Republican Guard's defense. And I believe it was, in a larger sense, it was a vindication of the battle-focused, tough, realistic training the United States Army had been doing for years.
이 첫 번째 교전 후 몇 분 뒤에 아군 M1A1 탱크 18대와 브래들리 장갑차 24대 그리고 포병 부대가 합류했다. 브래들리 장갑차에는 25mm 기관포와 기관총 그리고 터우 대전차 로켓이 장착돼 있다. 한편 포병은 곡사포와 다연발 로켓 수천 발을 발사해 적진을 초토화했다. 동향 73도 지점 전투라고 알려진 이 전투에서 미군은 압도적인 화력으로 불과 4시간 만에 공화국 수비대를 몰아냈다. 이를 통해 미 7군단은 승리의 발판을 마련했다.
When we turned our core 90 degrees to the east in this rolling attack with a fist, at that point in time, we had essentially 10 brigades, 10 armor brigades online attacking the Iraqis. That was the biggest battle of the war.
7군단은 드디어 레프트 훅 작전으로 적에게 치명타를 날릴 수 있는 기회를 맞이했다. 지상전 3일째에 얻은 동향 73도 지점 전투의 승리는 값진 것이었다. 이를 계기로 미 7군단 전 병력은 공화국 수비대 타르와카나 기갑사단의 본진에 대한 총 공세를 퍼붓기 위해 진격하게 되었다.
General Franks moved 1st Armored, 3rd Armored, and 1st Infantry all simultaneously together as a fist on the night of the 26th of February. And at 1000 hours in the evening, 2200 military time, the tanks of the 1st Infantry Division and our Bradley fighting vehicles all went hot against Republican Guard forces.
여기서도 동양 73도 전투의 전술이 응용되었다.
It was good for a number of reasons. It instilled a lot of confidence in the American troops, in their equipment, in their wherewithal to destroy the enemy at extended ranges. We have to understand that many, many of our troops did not understand the lethality of the tanks they were fighting with.
We had given credit to the T-72s and BMPs as being, while not on par with our Abrams tanks and our Bradley fighting systems, at least systems that were somewhat comparable. It turned out they were not even close to comparable.
에이브럼스 탱크와 브래들리 장갑차의 우월성은 조준 능력에서 두드러졌다. 특히 야간 적외선 투시를 통해 열로 적 탱크를 추적했다.
You can see an enemy tank that has retained some residual heat either from its own engine or from the sun hitting it most of the day. And so you can see that as a spot on your sight and you can put the aiming point on that. And the calculation of the ballistics equation is all done for you and the proper selection of the ammunition and you keep the aiming point on the target, you're going to hit it.
The ability to see through the weather, to see through the sandstorms, to see through the fog and smoke, and to see at night gave us the capability that enabled us to continuously surprise the Iraqis at the tactical level.
일단 적 탱크를 조준경에 포착하기만 하면 단 한 발로 끝내버렸다.
the most lethal weapon on the battlefield, at least in a direct firefight, was the main gun of the Abrams tank, the 120 gun. The soldiers referred to the service ammunition that we used in battle as the silver bullet. It's a depleted uranium round.
Depleted uranium is a hard material, much like tungsten, and so it provides a very dense, hard material that's easily manufactured and easily machined into this narrow, what we call long rod penetrator.
It's a round that has extraordinary penetration power.
The fundamental thing that you had, because of the density of the warhead, the munition stayed on course and on target, and you could shoot it further and hit where you were aiming.
T-72 탱크를 한 방에 파괴할 수 있었던 건 120mm 포탄의 정확도와 파괴력뿐 아니라 T-72 탱크의 설계 결함도 한 원인이었다.
The T-72 had the ammunition inside the crew compartment. And so when a spalling would take place, this very hot spalling caused by the penetration of the depleted uranium penetrator, this would cause a heat effect, which would in turn detonate the onboard ammunition. And then within a matter of probably half a second, you would see this explosion occur, horrendous explosion, onboard ammunition. And the turrets of the tank would spiral 30, 40, 50 feet up into the air once the hit took place.
Abrams 탱크는 이라크군 탱크에 비해 조준 발사 시간이 훨씬 짧다. 이라크 탱크는 유효 사거리가 1.6km 정도였지만 미군 탱크는 그 두 배의 거리에서도 명중시킬 수 있다는 게 전투를 통해 입증되었다.
This became a tactic very quickly. Our soldiers learned, don't close with the Iraqis, stay at range. We can hit them at long range and they can't hit us.
They were virtually ineffective in slowing down the totality and momentum of the army and the momentum of the corps. Find them, destroy them, continue to move. Find them, destroy them, continue to move. So at the end of the day, there were no pitched battles where one might draw comparisons to previous wars.
공화국 수비대의 타르와카나 사단은 하룻밤 만에 무너졌다. 다음 목표는 메디나 사단, 지상 최대의 전차전이 기다리고 있었다.
When we came in contact, there was a line of tanks and BMPs and artillery for as far as you could see. So we had fires across the front with tanks and Bradleys and BMPs, and then we had our artillery firing both at the front line positions and firing at their artillery in depth, and then the Apaches attacking even deeper in the zone against their artillery and their formations further in depth of the battlefield. It was a very brutal fight. Fortunately for us, it was very one-sided as well.
미군 5개 대대가 메디나 사단 제2여단과 아드난 사단의 일부 병력을 무찔렀다. 메디나 능선의 전투로 알려진 이 전투에서 300여 대의 이라크 탱크와 장갑차가 파괴되었다. 조직적인 방어선을 구축하려던 이라크군의 마지막 시도는 실패했다. 프랭크스 중장의 7군단이 본격적인 전투를 벌일 무렵 연합군 사령부에는 대규모의 이라크군 호성대열이 동쪽으로 이동해 쿠웨이트시 외곽 고속도로를 따라 북상하고 있다는 정보가 들어왔다.
Our first concern was how do we stop the Iraqis from returning this military equipment to Iraq? So we put airplanes that night in across the highway.
Roger, go 35 out of 1,000 for 4,000.
조종사들에게 반드시 이라크군 대열을 막으라는 지시가 떨어졌다. 사령관은 그 직전에 발생한 비극적인 소식을 전해주며 맹활약을 독려했다.
That a missile had just hit a barracks in Dahran, and that 60 or so servicemen were killed. And our mission was to go up and stop the retreating forces as they left Kuwait City. And he said, put some hate in your heart, and he'll be waiting here when we get back. When we took off, we had expected to see convoys leaving Kuwait City, but we weren't prepared for the magnitude, the number of vehicles that were on the ground that we saw when we broke out under the clouds.
즉시 폭격이 시작되었다. 대열의 선두와 후미에 폭탄이 떨어지면서 이라크군은 도로상에서 진퇴양난에 빠지고 말았다.
The headlights all went out. But because of the reflections of the oil fires and the twilight cast by the low clouds, I was able to still see all the vehicles on the road. Could see people jumping out of vehicles, could see doors opening, could see vehicles turning off into the sand, as well as those that we hit with our bombs.
F-15, B-52, Harrier, A-6, A-10 등을 총동원하여 이틀 동안 집중 폭격을 가했다.
When the pilots came on scene, there were literally thousands upon thousands of vehicles stalled, empty, jammed in this giant. And they turned it into a trash heap.
미군 조종사들은 시신과 부서진 차량으로 가득 찬 이 도로를 죽음의 고속도로라고 불렀다. 사망자가 수천 명에 이를 정도로 엄청난 참상이었다.
And it is 3 miles of the most amazing vehicular carnage you can imagine.
The Iraqi army didn't make a retreat at all. It was a headlong, panicky flight into disaster.
I don't know what the casualty count was there. We never got one, but I would say virtually every Iraq that was in that convoy was killed.
일부 언론에서는 무차별 학살이라고 보도했다. 투항 의사를 분명히 밝힌 적을 사살하는 것을 금지한 제네바 협약을 위반했다는 의혹마저 제기됐다.
This was an armed retreat, and when we were bombing, we were receiving constant fire. All types of anti-aircraft artillery, machine guns, and missiles were being shot at us the entire time. This was an armed retreat, not a turkey shoot.
There's no doubt about it. There's a lot of destruction and death. But that's war, and that's what people have to understand.
종전 후 연합군의 조사에 따르면 이 도로에서 약 1,500대의 차량이 파괴되었는데 그중 병력 수송용 장갑차는 2%에 불과했다. 나머지는 약탈한 쿠웨이트 차량이었다. 사망자 집계는 나중에 수천 명이 아니라 수백 명 수준으로 정정됐다. 하지만 당시에는 학살의 이미지가 강했다.
And it began to develop within the White House a concern about the public relations aspect of this victory. And after there were reports of a so-called highway of death, General Powell and President Bush became concerned that the American military not be seen as unnecessarily brutal as, quote, shooting fleeing Iraqis in the back. And they wanted to avoid this perception.
대통령과 군 수뇌부는 휴전을 고려하게 되었다. 사막의 폭풍 작전에 차질이 온 것이다. 군사적 목표보다 정치적 고려가 앞서게 되었다. 지상전 4일 만에 쿠웨이트시가 수복되고 7만여 명의 이라크 병사들이 이미 투항했다. 공화국 수비대의 타라카나 사단 전 병력과 메디나 사단 일부가 괴멸되었다. 이제 이라크 정규군과 공화국 수비대 모두 퇴각하기에 급급했다. 부시 대통령은 더 이상의 공격은 그저 살기 위해 도망치는 이라크 병사들을 학살하는 거라는 비난을 우려했다.
It was clear that Iraqi forces were running out of Kuwait as fast as they could run. You basically have this image that the Iraqis are running and we're slaughtering.
대통령은 특히 죽음의 고속도로에서의 대규모 인명 살상에 대한 여론 악화를 우려했다. 언론에서는 이 무자비한 공중 폭격을 도관에 든 쥐잡기라고 비난했다.
Everyone, of course, was aware of those media images. And so everyone knew what Bush was talking about when he said, we don't want to be subject to charges of brutalization.
지상전 돌입 83시간 만인 2월 27일, 파웰 합참의장은 슈워츠코프 대장에게 가능한 한 조기의 휴전을 원하는 백악관의 입장을 전달했다.
He told General Schwarzkopf, Norm, we're sitting here in the Oval Office having a conversation. The general sentiment is that it's about time to end it. Do you have a problem with that? That doesn't exactly invite dissent from General Schwarzkopf.
I got a query from General Schwarzkopf about, John, how much more time do you need to wrap this up? I asked for 24 more hours, which would have, instead of shutting the war off at daylight the following day, given us another day's worth of daylight to, as I call it, tidy up the battlefield.
대통령이 휴전의 조건들을 숙고하고 있는 동안 슈워츠코프 대장은 당시 가장 큰 논란을 불러일으킨 기자회견을 열었다. 너무나도 당당한 태도로 인해 언론 플레이의 극치였다는 평을 받은 이 회견에서 시어츠코프 대장은 어제 이미 승전했다고 선언했다.
We have rendered completely ineffective over 29 Iraqi divisions and the gates are closed. There is no way out of here. There is no way out of here and the enemy is fighting us in this location right here.
You said the gate was closed. Have you got ground forces blocking the roads to Basra?
No.
So is there any way that they can get out that way?
No. That's why the gates closed.
The Iraqis were not surrounded. The gates were not closed. There was no substantial means at hand for the American military to block passage into Basra, second largest city in Iraq. And certainly there was no means to block a passage out of Basra into the rest of Iraq.
He thought that more damage was being done to the Iraqis than in fact was being done. And he thought that air power had shut off the two Iraqi escape routes. Wasn't true. The Air Force had not closed Basra. They had not destroyed the causeway. And it wasn't through any lack of trying. But air power can only do so much. But if you're going to close a gate, if you're going to block a force, you need boots on the ground. And he didn't have it.
We continue, of course, to have overwhelming air power. The air has done a terrific job from start to finish.
So he misled people when he said the gate was closed. Most of all, he misled himself, and he certainly misled the administration.
This misapprehension was something that I think came back to haunt the American military to some extent, because it bespoke the fog of war in spades.
하지만 슈워츠코프 대장의 자신만만한 브리핑과 거의 막바지 단계에 접어든 지상전의 전황을 근거로 백악관은 휴전을 선포하기로 결정했다. 그러자 중부군 사령부에서는 공화국 수비대를 섬멸할 수 있는 기회를 놓치게 된 걸 안타까워했다.
Well, I said, I think that's a mistake. And Noam Schwarzkopf said to me, okay, you go get on the telephone and argue with him. I'm not going to argue anymore. I said, I'm not going to argue either. So we then sat down and started figuring out what all of this meant and how we were going to issue orders to stop the combat operation.
The fact that there was going to be a ceasefire came as an enormous surprise to the field commanders. And they were outraged by it, in addition to being surprised, because they felt that they had not completed their mission.
The destruction of the Republican Guard was one of the paramount military objectives of the war. It was put in writing in classified directives, and that's what General Powell had in mind when he gave his famous Pentagon press conference and said,
our strategy to go after this army is very, very simple. First, we're going to cut it off, and then we're going to kill it.
This was not a subsidiary goal. It was not a minor goal. It was a central goal, and yet half of the Republican Guard managed to escape.
I'm certainly not questioning the political decisions to stop the offensive operations, but General Schwarzkopf had given us the mission to destroy these divisions, and we knew we had not destroyed the Hammurabi at this point.
함무라비 사단은 공화국 수비대의 기갑사단 가운데서도 최강이었다. 공화국 수비대의 세계 보병 사단 역시 건재했다. 휴전 당시 미 7군단보다 북쪽에 있던 18군단은 전투 지역의 북쪽 경계선에 포진해 있던 적 4개 사단을 그대로 놓아주어야만 했다.
I think there was an element of disappointment because we were about to launch the final attack and close the last open gap of ground. And we were completely confident we'd do this successfully and rapidly.
베리 맥카프리 장군이 이끄는 24 보병 사단도 한 시간만 더 진격하면 이라크로 가는 두 개의 퇴각로 중 한 곳을 봉쇄할 수 있었다.
I think if the war had gone on for one more day, we would have sealed off the encircled force and taken away another 1,000 armored vehicles from them.
하지만 결정은 이미 내려졌다. 지상전 돌입 100시간 만에 전투가 중단되었다.
I am pleased to announce that at midnight tonight, Eastern Standard Time, exactly 100 hours since ground operations commenced and 6 weeks since the start of Operation Desert Storm, all United States and coalition forces will suspend offensive combat operations.
휴전 이틀 뒤에 맥카프리 장군의 제24 보병사단의 수색대가 북쪽으로 이동하던 함무라비 사단과 마주쳤다.
A huge enemy force, well armed, blundered into our positions and fired, and we took decisive action. And thankfully, no U.S. soldiers were killed.
General McCaffrey ordered that battalion and then the entire brigade and fundamentally the entire division to retaliate. The counterattack, which was entirely disproportionate to whatever offense the Iraqis may have given in the first place, lasted for hours.
이 치열한 공방전은 걸프전 사상 가장 큰 논란을 불러일으켰다. 2000년 5월에 뉴욕거지에서는 맥카프리 장군이 휴전에 순응하던 이라크군을 공격했다고 폭로했지만 조사 결과 이는 명백히 이라크군의 도발 행위였다고 밝혀졌다. 이라크로 돌아가는 퇴각로가 뚫린 채 휴전되고 공화국 수비대 병력 대부분이 장비의 절반 이상을 건진 채 퇴각할 수 있었다. 부시 대통령조차 이 승리를 아쉬운 심정으로 맞이했다.
You know, to be very honest with you, I haven't yet felt this wonderfully euphoric feeling that many of the American people feel. But I think it's that I want to see an end. You mentioned World War II. There was a definitive end to that conflict. And now we have Saddam Hussein still there.
In the end, the decision to make the war was made on political grounds more than military grounds. And I know from talking to people in the Bush administration that there really, at least among many of the civilians, was not an appreciation that half the Republican Guard was going to get away.
파벨 장군에 따르면 백악관도 공화국 수비대의 일부가 휴전 이후에 포위망을 빠져나갈 가능성을 알고 있었다. CIA 보고서에 따르면 그 규모가 얼마인지 드러난다. 공화국 수비대의 병력의 70%, 장비는 50% 정도였다. 이를 수습방관한 것도 두고두고 논란거리가 되었다.
Why would you leave roughly 40% of the Republican Guard tanks and heavy vehicles when all you had to do was to put a satchel charge in them or let a helicopter or an airplane put a bomb on top of it? And we have suffered from that and paid the price for that since the war ended.
물론 당시에도 미군이 바그다드까지 진격해 사담 후세인을 몰아내야 한다는 주장이 제기되었다.
Ladies and gentlemen, when we were here, we were 150 miles away from Baghdad and there was nobody between us and Baghdad. If it had been our intention to overrun the country, we could have done it unopposed.
Saddam would have fled. We were sure because we were in touch with the people inside, especially with the army generals in Baghdad.
걸프전 당시 이라크군 정보부 대장이었던 와피그 사마라이는 휴전이 선포될 때 사담 후세인과 함께 있었다.
He changed from a man sensing danger, sensing death was coming to him at any minute, to a man who escaped drowning and got away unscathed.
부시 행정부가 당시에 후세인 축출까지 시도하지 않았던 이유 중에는 연합국들이 협조하지 않을 거라는 우려도 깔려 있었다.
As long as we were leading the coalition liberating Kuwait, we were looked upon, I think, with great favor and widespread support in the Arab world. If we'd crossed over to the point where we were going to Baghdad, taking down an Arab government and replacing it with some other kind of government, then we would have been the colonial imperialist power and the perception would have been very different.
하지만 걸프전이 끝나자마자 사담 후세인을 축출하기 위한 투쟁이 이라크 내에서 일어났다. 남부 지역의 시아파를 주축으로 한 민간인들이 독재 정권을 타도하기 위해 무장 봉기에 나섰다. 걸프전 당시 부시 대통령도 권유했던 일이었다.
But there's another way for the bloodshed to stop. And that is for the Iraqi military and the Iraqi people to take matters into their own hands to force Saddam Hussein the dictator to step aside.
이라크 내에서 반정부 투쟁이 일어나자 백악관은 후세인 정권은 끝났다고 믿었다. 그런 인식 때문에 휴전 협정을 마무리하는 일은 아예 슈워츠코프 대장에게 다 이름해버렸다. 휴전 협정은 연합군이 점령하고 있는 사포안의 한 비행기지에서 열렸다.
I will tell you beyond the shadow of a doubt that when Norm Schwarzkopf went to meet with those generals from the other side. He had very little direction from anybody, whether it was from the president's advisors or whether it's from the State Department, as to what he was supposed to say or do.
시워츠코프 대장을 위시한 연합군 측은 포로 귀환 문제와 양측 간의 더 이상의 전투를 막기 위한 경계선을 확장하는 데만 관심을 두었다. 이라크군에게 군사 장비의 인도를 요구하지도 않았다. 연합군 협상단은 걸프 지역에서 하루라도 빨리 철수하고자 서둘렀다.
The American military was in such a hurry to withdraw from the region, I think it lost sight of the strategic consequences.
이라크 측은 모든 조항에 동의했다. 유일한 요구 사항은 헬기 비행을 허락해 달라는 것이었다.
Schwarzkopf was being magnanimous and he said yes, that would be okay. And the Iraqis were rather taken aback by this. They think they were surprised that the Americans were giving them this concession. And they said, you mean even helicopters that are armed in the sky can fly? And Schwarzkopf said essentially, sure, just keep them, don't keep them anywhere near us.
하지만 슈워츠코프 대장의 양보는 사담 후세인이 무력으로 시아파의 봉기를 진압하고 군 조직을 재정비하는 결과를 낳았다.
We made a classic American mistake, and that is usually, generally, normally, Americans will always try to be fair. We were trying to be fair to a country that we had just defeated overwhelmingly. We had no idea that they were going to use those armed helicopters in the manner that we did.
The decision to permit the helicopters to fly was a mistake. Everybody says, well, that's 20-20 hindsight. Permitting the helicopters to fly is not 20-20 hindsight to an airman. Had I been sitting at Safwan, I would have never agreed to that.
미군은 수만 명의 시아파 저항 세력이 학살당하는 것을 보고만 있었다. 후세인에 대한 무장 봉기에 나섰던 이라크 북부 쿠르드족 역시 같은 운명에 처했다. 하지만 쿠르드족이 완전히 말살되기 전에 연합군이 그나마 피난처를 제공했다.
We feel very bad because our relatives, our friends, our families are suffering, and the one reason for their suffering now is because the Allied, the Americans did not finish the job in 1991.
미국으로서는 이라크에서 신속하게 완전히 철수하는 게 급선무였다. 하지만 그 때문에 이후 10여 년간의 정치적 군사적 불안을 낳았다.
In fact, one of the three Republican Guard divisions earmarked for destruction in the Gulf War, the Hammurabi Division, later came back in the fall of 94 to menace Kuwait, one of the very same divisions that was earmarked for destruction.
걸프전 이후에 등장한 클린턴 정부는 1993년과 1998년 두 차례 이라크를 공격했다. 조지 W. 부시 대통령도 2001년에 취임한 지 불과 한 달 만에 바그다드 인근에 대한 공습을 추진했다. 미 군기들이 이라크 북부와 남부의 비행 금지 구역을 계속 정찰하며 레이더 시설과 방공포 진지를 폭격했다. 가장 큰 문제는 사담 후세인이 걸프전 이후 유엔의 대량 살상 무기 사찰 요구를 거부해 왔다는 것이었다. 이것도 걸프전처럼 흐지부지된 문제였다. 유엔 무기 사찰단에 따르면 최소한 8톤 가량의 탄저균을 비롯한 생화학 무기들이 잔존해 있다. 이라크는 베트남전처럼 전쟁의 수렁이 되지는 않았다. 하지만 걸프전은 사실상 끝난 게 아니었다.
The irony is in the rush for the exit and their desire to avoid a quagmire and their haste to get out of the region, the American military brought about the very situation that it feared. It brought about a situation where there is an open-ended quality to the conflict in the Gulf.
1991년 걸프전은 우리에게 교훈을 남겼다. 장병들의 귀국 환영 퍼레이드는 승리감을 만끽하게 해주었다.
I can report to the nation, aggression is defeated. the war is over.
Kuwait 국민들도 만세를 불렀다. 걸프전의 주 목표였던 이라크 군대의 퇴거가 이루어졌다.
Not everything in the Gulf War was successful or well thought out. But those things that seemed to have worked were direct lessons from Vietnam.
베트남전에서는 목표가 혼란스러웠지만 걸프전의 목표는 아주 분명했다.
The president himself said, I want Iraq out of Kuwait. I want minimum loss of life. I want him not be able to reconstitute and threaten his neighbors in the near future. And I want it over with quickly.
최소한의 병력을 사용하려 했던 베트남 정권은 대조적으로 걸프전에서 미국은 압도적인 병력을 동원해 승리를 쟁취했다. 이것이 바로 파웰 독트린이다.
The Powell doctrine of decisive force clearly worked, and it worked because we were not pressured into doing things prematurely before we had the wherewithal to do it with an absolute high degree of assurance of success.
압도적인 병력을 구성하기 위해 미군은 가용할 수 있는 모든 인적 물적 자원을 통합했다. 냉전 시대 소련군 전력의 핵심 요소였던 통합 지휘 체계의 강점을 미국이 처음으로 채택한 것이다.
Joint forces, joint air, naval, ground forces, synchronized and coordinated and focused appropriately is the right way to fight. And we had worked on the joint aspects of warfare for a number of years prior to the Gulf War, and it paid off in spades during that conflict.
특히 공군 전력이 걸프전에서 그 진가를 발휘했다.
Six weeks of air operation yielded a four-day ground campaign that was completed at exchange rates never heard of in the history of warfare. And analysts from the Army have looked at that afterwards, and they directly attribute our success on the ground, for example, with the residual effects of air attacks.
The Air Force, in my view, did a magnificent job for us. Number one, there weren't any Iraqi airplanes flying against me. So the greatest service the United States Air Force did in the Gulf War is they took away the Iraqi enemy Air Force. Secondly, politically, they were bombing deep to take away his ability to communicate, his ability to direct operations through those communications, and they did a superb job of that.
걸프전의 성공 이후 공군력은 코소보 분쟁과 아프간 사태에서도 결정적인 역할을 해냈다.
Air power has become the preeminent military force in the battlefield. And while it may not solve every problem, and it may not even be applicable in some situations, it's going to probably be the first choice of U.S. in terms of fighting wars.
하지만 공군력만으로 메울 수 없는 게 정확한 군사 첩보의 부족이다.
The lack of intelligence itself was singularly the most inhibiting thing in the Gulf War. Either inaccurate intelligence or the total lack of intelligence.
The 60-plus targets that were on the target list of chemical and biological-related facilities, only three of them had actual chemical and biological weapons stored at them during the war.
As it turned out, after the war, there were 39 nuclear sites, nuclear weapons development sites, in Iraq that we never saw. And a total of 239 of chemical and biological targets that we didn't know about. So our intelligence on one of the key aspects of the war, chemical, biological, and nuclear capabilities of the Iraqis was sadly deficient.
첩보 수집은 테러와의 전쟁에서도 계속 문제가 되고 있다. 하지만 사막의 폭풍 작전은 한 가지만큼은 놀라울 만한 성공을 거두었다. 미군 전사자가 불과 146명에 그치고 승리한 것이다. 전쟁 규모에 비하면 거의 무혈 전쟁이었다고 할 수 있다. 하지만 국민들의 기대 수준을 너무 높여놓았다는 문제도 있다.
Unfortunately, the principal lessons we took away from the Gulf War was the fact that we could fight and win very quickly with virtually nobody getting hurt. That lesson is one that has carried over in a very, very negative fashion.
The American military is afraid that if they have casualties, the Congress will complain, the people will complain, they'll be criticized as a failure. And really what you need to do is explain to people, hey, war is a dirty business, it's often very cruel, people get hurt, but it's something that's occasionally is necessary to defend your important and vital interests.
사막의 폭풍 작전은 실제 작전 개시 이전에 철두철미한 계획을 세웠다는 점에서 인정을 받는다. 하지만 휴전 이후의 상황에 대해서는 그렇지 못했다.
This sort of a cold war in the Persian Gulf region. Yes, we won our victory, but now we're committed to a containment strategy.
걸프전에 야무지지 못했던 마무리는 전쟁 계획뿐 아니라 그 이후의 평화 계획도 중요하다는 것을 시사하는 바가 크다. 에이브럼스 탱크와 브래들리 장갑차의 우월성은 조준 능력에서 두드러졌다. 특히 야간 적외선 투시를 통해 열로 적 탱크를 추적했다.
You can see an enemy tank that has retained some residual heat either from its own engine or from the sun hitting it most of the day. And so you can see that as a spot on your sight, and you can put the aiming point on that. And the calculation of the ballistics equation is all done for you, and the proper selection of the ammunition, and you keep the aiming point on the target, and you're going to hit it.
The ability to see through the weather, to see through the sandstorms, to see through the fog and smoke, and to see at night gave us the capability that enabled us to continuously surprise the Iraqis at the tactical level.
일단 적 탱크를 조준경에 포착하기만 하면 단 한 발로 끝내버렸다.
The most lethal weapon on the battlefield at least in a direct firefight, was the main gun of the Abrams tank, the 120 gun. The soldiers referred to the service ammunition that we used in battle as the silver bullet. It's a depleted uranium round.
Depleted uranium is a hard material, much like tungsten, and so it provides a very dense, hard material that's easily manufactured and easily machined into this narrow, what we call long rod penetrator.
It's a round that's has extraordinary penetration power.
The fundamental thing that you had, because of the density of the warhead, the munition stayed on course and on target, and you could shoot it further and hit where you were aiming.
T-72 탱크를 한 방에 파괴할 수 있었던 건 120mm 포탄의 정확도와 파괴력뿐 아니라 T-72 탱크의 설계 결함도 한 원인이었다.
The T-72 had the ammunition inside the crew compartment. And so when a spalling would take place, this very hot spalling caused by the penetration of the depleted uranium penetrator, this would cause a heat effect which would in turn detonate the onboard ammunition. And then within a matter of probably half a second, you would see this explosion occur. Horrendous explosion. Onboard ammunition. And the turrets of the tank would spiral 30, 40, 50 feet up into the air once the hit took place.
Abrams 탱크는 이라크군 탱크에 비해 조준 발사 시간이 훨씬 짧다. 이라크 탱크는 유효 사거리가 1.6km 정도였지만 미군 탱크는 그 두 배의 거리에서도 명중시킬 수 있다는 게 전투를 통해 입증되었다.
This became a tactic very quickly. Our soldiers learned, don't close with the Iraqis, stay at range. We can hit them at long range and they can't hit us.
They were virtually ineffective in slowing down the totality and momentum of the army and the momentum of the corps. Find them, destroy them, continue to move. Find them, destroy them, continue to move. So at the end of the day, there were no pitched battles where one might draw comparisons to previous wars.
공화국 수비대의 타르와카나 사단은 하룻밤 만에 무너졌다. 다음 목표는 메디나 사단, 지상 최대의 전차전이 기다리고 있었다.
When we came in contact, there was a line of tanks and BMPs and artillery for as far as you could see. So we had fires across the front with tanks and Bradleys and BMPs, and then we had our artillery firing both at the front line positions and firing at their artillery. In depth, and then the Apaches attacking even deeper in the zone against their artillery and their formations further in depth of the battlefield. It was a very brutal fight. Fortunately for us, it was very one-sided as well.
미군 다섯 개 대대가 메디나 사단 제2여단과 아드난 사단의 일부 병력을 무찔렀다. 메디나 능선의 전투로 알려진 이 전투에서 300여 대의 이라크 탱크와 장갑차가 파괴되었다. 조직적인 방어선을 구축하려던 이라크군의 마지막 시도는 실패했다. 프랭크스 중장의 7군단이 본격적인 전투를 벌일 무렵 연합군 사령부에는 대규모의 이라크군 호성대열이 동쪽으로 이동해 쿠웨이트시 외곽 고속도로를 따라 북상하고 있다는 정보가 들어왔다.
Our first concern was how do we stop the Iraqis from returning this military equipment to Iraq? So we put airplanes that night in across the highway.
조종사들에게 반드시 이라크군 대열을 막으라는 지시가 떨어졌다. 사령관은 그 직전에 발생한 비극적인 소식을 전해주며 맹활약을 독려했다.
That a missile had just hit a barracks in Dahran and that 60 or so servicemen were killed. And our mission was to go up and stop the retreating forces as they left Kuwait City. And he said, put some hate in your heart, and he'll be waiting here when we get back. When we took off, we had expected to see convoys leaving Kuwait City, but we weren't prepared for the magnitude, the number of vehicles that were on the ground that we saw when we broke out under the clouds.
즉시 폭격이 시작되었다. 대열의 선두와 후미에 폭탄이 떨어지면서 이라크군은 도로상에서 진퇴양난에 빠지고 말았다.
The headlights all went out, but because of the reflection,
모래바람을 뚫고 공화국 수비대를 찾아 진격하던 제7군단의 최선봉은 맥마스터 대위가 이끄는 기갑중대였다.
We really were going into an uncertain situation and we were doing our job as cavalry troopers. We were going out, riding out in front of the main formation, much like cavalry has done in centuries past to find the enemy's defensive positions.
지상전에 돌입한 지 60시간이 되던 무렵 모래 언덕에 숨어있던 타라카나 사단 이하의 한 기갑 여단이 갑자기 나타났다. 서로 물러설 수 없이 가까운 거리였다.
So immediate what happened is the entire crew went into action. Sergeant Koch, my gunner, is engaging targets. Our loader is loading the appropriate ammunition, yelling up and arming the gun. Well, Sergeant Koch lays on the next target and destroys it.
They attacked in a sandstorm, and so a lot of units, maybe that weren't perhaps as well trained as they, weren't as confident as they, might have stopped and just called artillery and waited till the sandstorm stopped. The Iraqis were surprised that they attacked in that bad weather.
What I remember most vividly are the first rounds from our tank. The first round was a heat round, so it made a tremendous explosion as it hit the enemy tank. I remember the tank commander was thrust out of the hatch of the tank and he himself was on fire. As my tank was moving to engage other enemy tanks, we got three rounds off just before our other eight tanks came up over the ridge and were able to engage the enemy. And what I remember then is the entire enemy defense seemed to explode in a ball of fire.
It all is summed up in my mind by a report that I asked for from all of the senior Iraqis who were captured. When did you first know you were under attack? I mean, this is all the lieutenant colonels and generals. The most common answer that the Iraqis responded, we knew we were under attack when the vehicles around me started to explode.
불과 30초 만에 소련제 T-72를 필두로 한 이라크 탱크 8대가 화염에 휩싸였다. 미군의 M1A1 탱크는 거의 철벽에 가까운 철제 장갑 덕에 끄떡없었다. 63톤이나 나가는 육중한 무게였지만 사막에서도 시속 56km의 속력으로 움직일 수 있었다. 거기에다 120mm 활강포의 위력 또한 대단했다.
The rate of fire of our weapon systems was a tremendous advantage. We could fire about 3 rounds for every 1 round of the Iraqi tanks. The Iraqi tanks relied on automatic loaders. And those automatic loaders were cumbersome. They took a long time to get a second round in. So while we know of 4 Iraqi tanks that fired at us, no Iraqi tanks got a second round off.
23분 동안의 교전 끝에 이라크 탱크 30대와 장갑차 16대가 파괴 1991년 2월 24일 미 해병대가 쿠웨이트시를 향해 북쪽으로 진격을 개시한 지 10시간 후 지상군의 본 공격이 진행되었다. 이라크군의 배후를 치는 일명 레프트 훅이라는 대대적인 기갑 작전이었다.
We wanted to attack them and hit them in the flank before they knew the direction and the size of the attack.
Ready to roll, whatever. Good, we're running good.
Yeah. 레프트 훅을 치는 임무는 프레드 프랭크스 중장이 이끄는 제7군단이 맡았다. 목표는 이라크군의 최정예 핵심 전력이라고 할 수 있는 공화국 수비대의 3개 기갑사단을 섬멸하는 것이었다.
We knew that the Republican Guards, who were well-armed, well-equipped, the best trained of the Iraqi forces, who were our principal mission and our focus of our attack, that they would fight back, that they would attempt to maneuver, and that they were a much more skillful and motivated force than the frontline Iraqi units.
해병대가 공격했던 이라크군은 징집병으로 구성된 전방부대로서 훈련도 부족하고 장비도 형편없었다. 게다가 연합군의 공습으로 심한 타격을 받은 상태였다. 하지만 공화국 수비대는 상황이 달랐다.
There were three heavy divisions, armored mechanized divisions equipped with the Soviet T-72 tanks, very good tanks, and the BMPs, first line infantry carriers. So it was good equipment. Our intelligence said they were disciplined, they were tough, they would fight to the death.
공화국 수비대는 쿠웨이트 북부의 국경선을 따라 7개 사단을 포진해 놓았다. 미군은 제7군단의 5개 사단과 18군단 소속 4개 사단을 동원해 진격했다. 그러다가 쌍방은 최강의 부대끼리 전투를 치르게 되었다. 미 제7군단 소속 3개 기갑사단 대 공화국 수비대 소속 기갑사단인 타르와카나, 메디나, 그리고 함무라비 사단과의 격돌이었다.
We started out attacking to the north, and then we would have to turn 90 degrees to the east in essentially a left hook. I wanted to do that without stopping and to hit the Republican Guards with a 3 armored division fist, approximately over 1,000 tanks and some 600 infantry fighting vehicles.
반면 미군은 단 한 대의 피해도 없었다. 불과 9대의 탱크로 수적으로 4배가 넘는 이라크의 최정예 기갑사단 병력을 섬멸시키는 대전과를 올린 것이다.
It was an enormously successful attack for our corps. It fixed the Republican Guards defense. It discovered the southern edge of the Republican Guards defense. And I believe it was in a larger sense, it was a vindication of the battle-focused, tough, realistic training the United States Army had been doing for years.
이 첫 번째 교전 후 몇 분 뒤에 아군 M1A1 탱크 18대와 브래들리 장갑차 24대 그리고 포병부대가 합류했다. 브래들리 장갑차에는 25mm 기관포와 기관총 그리고 터우 대전차 로켓이 장착돼 있다. 한편 포병은 곡사파와 다연발 로켓 수천 발을 발사해 적진을 초토화했다. 동향 73도 지점 전투라고 알려진 이 전투에서 미군은 압도적인 화력으로 불과 4시간 만에 공화국 수비대를 몰아냈다. 이를 통해 미 7군단은 승리의 발판을 마련했다.
When we turned our core 90 degrees to the east in this rolling attack with a fist. At that point in time, we had essentially 10 brigades, 10 armor brigades online attacking the Iraqis. That was the biggest battle of the war.
7군단은 드디어 레프트 훅 작전으로 적에게 치명타를 날릴 수 있는 기회를 맞이했다. 지상전 3일째 얻은 동향 73도 지점 전투의 승리는 값진 것이었다. 이를 계기로 미 7군단 전 병력은 공화국 수비대 타르와카나 기갑사단의 본진에 대한 총 공세를 퍼붓기 위해 진격하게 되었다.
General Franks moved 1st Armored, 3rd Armored, and 1st Infantry all simultaneously together as a fist on the night of the 26th of February. And at 1000 hours in the evening, 2200 military time, the tanks of the 1st Infantry Division and our Bradley fighting vehicles all went hot against Republican Guard forces.
여기서도 동양 73도 전투의 전술이 응용되었다.
It was good for a number of reasons. It instilled a lot of confidence in the American troops, in their equipment, in their wherewithal to destroy the enemy at extended ranges. We have to understand that many, many of our troops did not understand the lethality of the tanks they were fighting with.
We had given credit to the T-72s and BMPs